Hello, my name is Peter Victor. I'm an economist and a professor in environmental studies at York University. I'm going to talk to you about a particular kind of system change. The system I'm interested in is the economic system, and in particular, its relationship to the environment. Let's start with a picture of an economy. Here you can see the most simple picture of an economy that we present to students of economics. It shows the economy divided between firms and households. The firms provide the goods and services that households buy, and the households are the supplier of land and labor and capital, which they ultimately own, which they sell to the firms. And we talk about the economic cycle, showing the goods and services going in one direction and the money going in the other direction, rather like that. But the problem with this representation of an economy is that it's completely in absence of any connection to the environment. So let's put in some of those connections. Here we can see the sources of materials and energy without which no economy can function. And you can see they're being drawn directly from nature. Now, all of the materials and energy that are used by an economy are ultimately disposed of by the economy back into the environment as waste. And so at the top of the diagram, you can see the discharge of all of these waste materials and energy back into the environment. Now, in 2011, we've got two categories of problems. We've got problems that the sources are no longer able to supply us with cheap materials, and we're overloading some of the sinks, in particular climate. The capacity of the atmosphere to absorb greenhouse gases is affecting the climate. And what's happening now is that as we overload these sinks, it's interfering with the biophysical cycles that define our planet. This could be the carbon cycle, the sulfur cycle, the nutrient cycles, and so on. And all this is taking place on planet Earth. Now, the only thing of any consequence that's entering the planet is solar energy, and what's leaving is waste heat. Now, right in the center of that diagram, you can see the economy. If we're really going to understand how to fix the economy in relation to the environment, then we must always maintain in our mind's eye this sort of picture of what an economy is. Now let's look at some data. First, let's look at all of the materials that our economy, and I'm looking at the world here, has required over the last century or so. If we look at what happened in the first half of the 20th century, you can see that there was that steady increase in the extraction of materials that were used to drive the world's economies. And you can see the materials consist of construction minerals, ores and industrial materials, fossil energy carriers, which means all fossil fuels, and biomass. But now let's look at the second half of the 20th century. And what you see is an absolutely massive increase in the amount of materials and energy that we use to drive the world's economy. And of course, to anybody looking at this graph, you'd have to say, well, how much longer can that continue? Well, now let's look at the other end of our diagram. We take all that material and all that energy, use it, and then dispose of it back into the environment. We put pressure on the environment. And here's a very interesting chart that shows nine globally significant environmental problems that are ultimately all being caused by this rapid and massive increase in the amount of materials and energy that our economies use. You can see there, and I won't read them all, but starting at the top, climate change, ocean acidification, stratospheric ozone depletion, and so on. Now, in the center of this diagram, you can see a green circle. That green circle signifies the safe operating space on the planet that humans can occupy. If we can stay within that boundary, we'll be okay. But the scientists who developed this particular diagram have concluded that at least with respect to three of those issues already, climate change, the sulfur cycle, and loss of biomass, we've already far exceeded the capacity of the planet to cope with these pressures, and we're pushing outward on some of the others. One of the main drivers of all of this, and what's made it possible, is the extent to which we have increased our use of fossil fuels, coal, energy, and natural gas. Now, this graph goes back 2,000 years, and you can see for most of the 2,000 years, we didn't use significant quantities at all. And then in the last two and a half centuries, a massive and rapid increase in fossil fuel use. Some people, and I'm among those, are questioning how long that can last, simply because in particular with respect to oil, the cheap sources and easy to get sources of oil seem to have been used up. But a lot of very influential people in positions of administrative significance, such as Dr. Birol at the International Energy Agency, are also having concerns about these problems. And here he is saying that the output of conventional oil will peak in 2020 if oil demand grows on a business as usual basis. There are many commentators who put the date earlier than 2020. The conclusion that I draw from all of this is that just trying to solve our problems by becoming more efficient, by reducing the intensity of our activities, will not be sufficient to solve the problems. We have to address the scale of our economy as well. And here's a further evidence of why I think that's so important. This graph goes from 1980 to 2005. The heavy line in the middle is the total amount of primary energy that the world's economies have used during that period. And you can see that it's increased by 59% over that 25-year period. Now, during that period, our energy intensity declined. What that means is that the energy we require for each dollar of output of the world's economies has declined. We have, in many respects, become more efficient. The trouble is we've not become more efficient fast enough, and so the increase in the total output of the economy as measured by gross domestic product, GDP, has gone up much faster than our intensity has declined. And of course, it's the combined effect of the scale of the economy and the intensity that leads to the increase in primary energy. The result is that we conclude that our environmental impact of all kinds depends upon the scale of our economic activity, the size of the economy, and the intensity with which our activities are conducted. Well, I set out to look at what might happen if we tried to manage our economy in a country like Canada without relying on economic growth. And I developed a macroeconomic model on my computer to investigate a particular issue. The question I set myself to answer was the following: can we have full employment, no poverty, fiscal balance, and reduce greenhouse gas emissions without relying on economic growth? Now, let me make it quite clear that my focus is very much on the rich countries, where I believe we're already producing enough goods and services to satisfy more than all of our needs in this country. The poorer countries, it's a different situation. Well, here's the answer to that question. Yes, I do believe we can meet all those objectives without having an economy that grows. Let me explain why. Well, first of all, let's see what makes an economy grow. We can look at it from the demand side. What is it we spend money on? Well, we spend money on consumption when we go to the shops and buy the things that are there for sale. That counts as the output of the economy. When companies spend money on new equipment, that also is part of gross domestic product, the output of our economy. When governments buy goods and services themselves, that's also part of the output of the economy. And if we run a trade balance, if we sell more to others than we buy from them, that counts as part of our economic output. But we can also look at economic growth from the supply side. What are we capable of producing? That depends upon our labor force, its size, its skills, the extent to which it's employed. It depends upon our capital equipment, the same thing. How big is it? How efficient is it? And so on, and how much of it's employed. And also on all sorts of things that we wrap up into this term productivity, which can include organizational improvements as well as technological. Well, if we project the economy of Canada into the future, starting from 2005 to 2035, and say, how would it perform if it behaved as it has done for the previous 30 years? We get a picture that looks like this. And you can see that the top black line shows that gross domestic product per person rises steadily. Greenhouse gas emissions, the green line, also rise steadily, not quite as fast because the intensity is declining, but not fast enough to counteract the increase in the size of the economy. The blue line is unemployment. It goes up and comes down again. The red line at the bottom is the government's debt to GDP ratio. Now, this projection was done as of 2005. A number of things have happened since then, but this still gives us the kind of broad trajectory that the economy would be on if we could get back to where we were before, which is very much what many people would like to see us do. But you'll also notice the brown line, the poverty line, which is rising steadily in that graph. So even though the economy more than doubles over that 30-year period, if we carry on as we've done in the past, there will be more poor Canadians at the end of the 30 years than there are at the beginning, largely because there'll be more Canadians. Well, now what would happen if we took out all of the impetus for growth in this economy? Well, you might expect it to be disastrous, and you wouldn't be far wrong. Here's what the scenario might look like. In this scenario, I started eliminating the drivers of growth from 2010 and brought them down to zero by 2020, and what you see happening is unemployment goes off the graph, poverty shoots way up because unemployed people are very often poor, made poorer by that experience. The government's debt to GDP ratio gets completely unmanageable because revenues have gone down and expenses have gone up. Ultimately, there is no growth. GDP per capita settles out towards the end of the scenario, and greenhouse gas emissions are about where they were in 2005. Question is, can we do better? Well, lots of people are asking this question. For example, Larry Elliott from The Guardian Weekly in Britain wrote in 2008 that the real issue is whether it's possible to challenge the growth at any cost model and come up with an alternative that is environmentally benign, economically robust, and politically feasible. Well, I believe it is. And here's an example of a better low or no growth scenario. Now, you see, in this scenario, again, I've introduced measures starting in 2010 and running for the next 10 years so that ultimately economic growth is ended, and by the end of this period, GDP per capita is constant. But look at some of the other things. Unemployment has come way down, lower than we've had for 50 years. The government's debt to GDP ratio looking very healthy. The poverty level has come way down. And by the way, poverty in this model is measured as the UN measures it with their human poverty index. And most particularly, greenhouse gas emissions have come down well below where they were in 2005. So how would we bring this about if we decided this is the way we wanted to go? Well, there are many things we'd have to do. The first thing we have to do is completely revise what we understand by success, both nationally, regionally, at our communities, and our own lives. We, in my view, place far too much emphasis on the acquisition of material things to define success when we really know that that's really not the only thing that makes for a good life. Part of the problem is that we crave status and we try to satisfy that craving by buying status goods. We have to find a way of solving that problem. Another thing that I think we have to do is we have to discipline ourselves so that we do not keep going back to nature for increasing amounts of materials and energy and imposing increasing amounts of waste on nature, because the system cannot stand that. In these scenarios that I'm showing you, or the one that's up there now, there's an assumption that the population has been stabilized and that the labor force has been stabilized. There's also the introduction of a carbon price. One of the reasons why there's so much discharge of greenhouse gases into the environment is because it can be done for free. We know that if there was a price, then people would do it less, and that would help solve that problem that's included in this particular scenario. But if carbon was priced, it would also affect all other prices in the economy, because directly or indirectly, they all are based upon fossil fuel use. We definitely need more efficient capital, which means better equipment, whether that's in industry or whether it's in our homes, whether it's the cars we drive, and that would be partly the result of more informative prices. We can still benefit from improvements in productivity and better technology, but the way I think we should be benefiting is to work less, have more leisure, more time with our families, with our communities, doing our hobbies, and so on. I think that's all part of meeting those new measures of success. If we're going to deal with poverty, trickle-down doesn't work. We definitely need more generous anti-poverty programs, and those have been built into the scenario that you can see before you. And finally, let me just say that as an educator, we need to make sure that we educate our children and our students for life and not just for work. Could we adapt to this kind of scenario? Well, I believe as people, we're very adaptable. We've proven that throughout human history. But can our institutions adapt? And here's some pictures of famous institutions in Canada, our university, our central bank, our legislature, and so on. And there's some global institutions as well, manufacturing and resale. All of these institutions would have to adjust in different ways to a life which didn't depend upon the endless pursuit of economic growth. However, if we don't make the changes, I do believe that the future is rather bleak. And I'm sorry to say this, now that I'm a grandfather and I look at the life ahead for my grandchildren, I'm quite concerned about what lies out there for them. But I'm also an optimist, and I do think we can make the sorts of changes I've outlined for you. And if we do that, then I think that the future is much brighter. And that's the kind of future that I think we should work for. Thank you very much for your attention.